church today. Welcome to this balmy weather. Now, hey, it'll be warm by the end of the week. Turn around and say hi to somebody next to you. Say you're glad to see them today. Glad to have y'all watching at home. And we're going to have a great time today. Want to mention something to you. You'll see in the slides about Salt and Light this Wednesday. Salt and Light has been canceled for this Wednesday. We had a water break down in the kitchen area, and they're still, it's fixed, but they're still doing the aftermath of that. So one more week, and then we'll get Salt and Light started up. So no Salt and Light this Wednesday, no matter what the slides say. Okay, let's have a word of prayer, and we will begin. Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you for this day. We ask that your Holy Spirit would have his way in everything that's done in your precious and wonderful name. Amen. Amen. And here's what's happening at Kimberling City Methodist Church. Kimberling City Methodist Church, we are so glad that you are here today. We'd love for you to experience any one of our three distinctive worship experiences. At 8 a.m., we have Front Porch Gospel with its toe-tapping bluegrass gospel music. And then at 9:15, we have traditional service with our choir, our bells. And then at 10:30, we have a service with more of a cafe setting. Any one of those free experiences are available to you each and every Sunday here at Kimberling City Methodist Church.
Well, one of these mornings, I'm gonna see Jesus face to face, thank him for his amazing grace, finding him a resting place. One of these mornings, oh yes,
one of these mornings,
yes, now, one of these mornings,
I'm gonna see Jesus,
yes, I'm gonna see Jesus.
One of these mornings,
yes, now, one of these mornings,
I'm gonna go
home. I'm gonna go home.
I'm gonna put on my robe of love, walk them golden streets above, lay down my cross, pick up my crown. One of these mornings.
Sorrow, there'll be no more tomorrow, there'll be no more crying. Well, when we get home,
God knows I'm gonna preach,
pray,
sing,
shout.
I'm gonna live on up in the glory one of these mornings.
There'll
be no more sorrow,
there'll be no more sorrow,
there'll be no more tomorrow,
there'll be no more tomorrow,
there'll be no more crying,
there'll be no more crying.
Well, when I get home,
yes, when I get home,
God knows I'm gonna shout,
shout,
God knows I'm gonna live on up in the glory one of these mornings.
Oh,
there'll be no more sorrow,
there'll be no more sorrow,
there'll be no tomorrow,
there'll be no more tomorrow,
there'll be no more crying,
there'll be no more crying.
Well, when I get home,
yes, when I get home,
God knows I'm gonna shout,
gonna shout, God knows I'm gonna live on up in the glory.
right, y'all have a lot of work to do this morning. There's not very many of you, so y'all have to sing double. So stand up and let's sing together, "Thy Word is a Lamp Unto My Feet."
As we go before the Lord in prayer today, there are many people in our congregation and in our community that are counting on us to pray for them. One particular one we want to pray for this week is Miss Frida is going to have surgery. Is that Thursday? Thursday this week. Be sure and be lifting her up in prayer, and that everything will go smoothly with that. Let's think of one need that we know of, and let's pray together. Father, we thank you and praise you. God, that you are a God that hears and answers prayer. You're a God that performs miracles in our lives. Father, we live on that. And today, Father, we just ask that you would intercede on the behalf of our many friends, our brothers and sisters in Christ who need a touch today. Those that may be down, Father, may they be lifted up. Those that need healing, may they receive the healing balm of Gilead. We just thank you and we praise you in your precious name. And we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
This choir's going to tell you what heaven's going to be like this morning. This old world is not where I belong. Heaven is. It was only meant to be my home. Heaven is. Heaven is where the glorious Lamb of God forever reigns. Heaven is where I'll sing one day with the angels and the saints. Ask me what is waiting, because the Savior made me his. Heaven is. Heaven is.
So I was just thinking, I'm really glad that the choir people didn't wake up this morning and open the door and say, oh man, it's too cold, I'm staying home today. I'm glad they were here. Appreciate you guys, each and every one of you in the choir, and what a beautiful job. And it's part of what makes worship encouraging and helpful, and that is we just show up. Obviously, there are times in the winter when everybody can't come. We had to cancel last Sunday. It was just, here's the thing about it. We have a few of our members who would be described as of advancing years, like myself. And when it comes down to a demographic of who is the most dedicated and the most likely to brave the elements and show up for church, guess who it is? Tends to be those who are the most mature and senior among us. You got 90-year-olds, they're going to be the first ones there on the snowiest day of the year. And we just thought for the cold and the safety of everyone, it would be a good time to just say, stay home. We put out a little video message. Appreciate everybody watching that. I noticed we had, I don't know, 250, 300 views on that or whatever. So I don't know, we had at least as good attendance on that as we do in church on Sunday morning. But there's always something different about actually worshiping in person as to watching a video, right? I prefer the in-person because nothing compares to that. And so this is the second part of the Immovable series that we started, but it's also a continuation of the message that I did on the video last weekend when we sent that out. My theme on that was really dealing with the unexpected. And last week, the first message in this series was, you know, obviously the theme is how do we maintain our faith and how can we be encouraged and be faithful in the midst of absolute chaos all around us. And last Sunday we talked about the chaos that we create. Sometimes we are the ones who make the chaos. And today it's the chaos that we encounter that's completely out of our control. And that's probably the kind that's more concerning than just about anything else. If we look around us in the world today, the political scene, it's just an absolute mess. Nothing is going to get better in that regard. We can expect that to just spiral downward for the most part. I mean, occasionally things seem to stabilize, but then there's other factors that arrive. And we don't find the stability with that. And historically speaking, I would say in our culture, go back 3-4 decades, and even more than that, and we could expect a certain amount of predictability and not even so much repetitiveness, but as a pattern and a structure of life for most people that was pretty easy to get and to follow. If you remember the movie Pleasantville, did any of you watch that? And if you remember, William H. Macy comes in from work and he enters the door. It's all black and white, like old movies. Got his hat, his suit, and everything. Honey, I'm home. And he takes off his hat, puts his hat where he always puts it, and he goes into the dining room, and there's no dinner on the table for him. And he's out in the middle of the street a few minutes later, and he's saying, "Where's my dinner?" And he rehearses it. He walks through the pattern. He says, "I don't understand. Every day, Monday through Friday, I come home from work at 5:30 in the evening. I say, 'Honey, I'm home.' I put my hat right here. I walk to the dining room, and there's my dinner. Today, I came in. I said, 'Honey, I'm home.' I put my hat right here. I went to the dining room, and there's no dinner. What am I going to..." He was just completely taken aback. He could not move forward or do anything else because the pattern had been upset. Well, if we look at the world around us today, every single pattern has been upset. There aren't any anymore. We would like that, and we try to hold those in place and stabilize what we can in the world around us, but we recognize we are just in an almost overwhelming state of chaos around us, whether it's some of the dystopian things that are happening politically and in that arena, or whether it's the fact that families are so scattered today, or that employment is so insecure for so many. You know, it just goes on and on. And we recognize that we're going to encounter quite a lot of chaos in life. So how do we deal with that? The story I want to take from the Bible, and I'll admit, you guys, I'm going to read more scripture today than what I usually do on Sunday morning, but it's a really good story, okay? So follow along with this. So the background of the scripture we're going to read is, it's in Acts chapter 27. But if you remember, Paul the Apostle finally had been arrested and was being taken to Rome to stand trial. And throughout the course of getting him from Pisidian Antioch all the way to Rome to stand trial, there's a lot that happened. And one of the big things that happened was a shipwreck. And that's the story I want to read today, because that was probably the most traumatic part of the entire journey for him. And this is written by Luke, the same author who wrote Luke's gospel. A couple of things you can note. If it's written by Luke, he was referred to as both a historian and a physician. And he was always painstakingly careful about the details. So far as adding in a secular event or a calendar holiday or something, anything like that, that would make sure that you couldn't misplace the timing of the events he was talking about. So a great historian and a great and careful writer. And let's start with verse 1 in Acts chapter 27. I'll try to skip a few verses, but I want you to get the gist of this story, okay? Here it is. When it was decided that we would sail for Italy, Paul and some other prisoners were handed over to a centurion named Julius, who belonged to the imperial regiment. And when we had sailed across the open sea off the coast of Cilicia and Pamphylia, we landed at Myra in Lycia. And there the centurion found an Alexandrian ship sailing for Italy, and they put us on board. And we made slow headway for many days. We had difficulty arriving at Cnidus. When the wind did not allow us to hold our course, we sailed to the lee of Crete opposite Salmone. We moved along the coast with difficulty. We came to a place called Fair Havens near the town of Lycia, and much time had been lost, and sailing had already become dangerous. So Paul warned them, "Men, I can see that our voyage is going to be disastrous and will bring great loss to the ship and cargo and to our own lives also." But the centurion, instead of listening to what Paul said, followed the advice of the pilot and of the owner of the ship. And since the harbor was unsuitable to winter in, the majority decided that we should sail on, hoping to reach Phoenix and winter there. And this was a harbor in Crete, facing both southwest and northwest. And when a gentle south wind began to blow, they saw their opportunity, so they weighed anchor and sailed along the shore to Crete. Before long, a wind of hurricane force called a northeaster swept down from the island. And the ship was caught by the storm, could not head into the wind. So we gave way to it and were driven along. As we passed to the lee of a small island called Cauda, we were hardly able to make the lifeboat secure. So the men hoisted it aboard. Then they passed the ropes under the ship itself to hold it together, because they were afraid they would run aground on the sandbars of Syrtis. And they lowered the sea anchor and let the ship be driven along. We took such a violent battering from the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. And when neither sun nor stars appeared for many days and the storm continued raging, we finally gave up all hope of being saved. After they had gone a long time without food, Paul stood up before them and said, "Men, you should have taken my advice not to sail from Crete. Then you would have spared yourselves this damage and loss. But now I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost, only the ship will be destroyed. Last night, an angel of the God whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me and said, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar. God has graciously given you the lives of all who sail with you. So keep your courage, men. For I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. Nevertheless, we must run aground on an island.' On the 14th night, we were still being driven across the Adriatic Sea, when about midnight, the sailors sensed they were approaching land. They took soundings, found that the water was 120 feet deep, and a short time later took soundings again and found it was 90 feet deep. And fearing that we would be dashed against the rocks, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight. In an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. Then Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved. So the soldiers cut the ropes that held the lifeboat and let it drift away. And just before dawn, Paul urged them all to eat. For the last 14 days, he said, you have been in constant suspense and have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. And now I urge you to take some food. You need it to survive, and not one of you will lose a single hair from his head. After he said this, he took some bread. He gave thanks to God in front of them all, and he broke it and began to eat. They were all encouraged. They ate some food themselves. Altogether, there were 276 of us on board. When they had eaten as much as they wanted, they lightened the ship by throwing the grain into the sea. When daylight came, they did not recognize the land, but they saw a bay with a sandy beach, where they decided to run the ship aground if they could. And cutting loose the anchors, they left them in the sea, and at the same time untied the ropes that held the rudders. Then they hoisted the foresail to the wind and made for the beach. But the ship struck a sandbar and ran aground. The bow stuck fast and wouldn't move, and the stern was broken to pieces by the pounding of the surf. The soldiers then planned to kill the prisoners to prevent any of them from swimming away and escaping. But the centurion wanted to spare Paul's life and kept them from carrying out the plan. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land. The rest were to get there on planks or on other pieces of the ship. In this way, everyone reached land safely. Quite a story, isn't it? I mean, how many of you have boats and you get out on Table Rock Lake here very much? Do you have anybody? I figure a lot of you here. We have lots of boat people in our church, lots of lake people. Did you cringe a little bit when they said they were unable to face into the wind, so they had to turn it around and just let the wind drive them? That's a scary position to be in out on a lake, and certainly on the open sea. And there's just event after event in this where everything is out of control, and nothing that Paul can do or nothing anyone else can do seems to be able to stabilize the situation. And that's why I wanted to use this story. It is such a parallel to what we experience in life with all the chaos that we encounter. And they certainly did plenty of it here. Amazing that all 276 people survived that, given the situation, and yet somehow they did. So I want to get into this just a little bit and have some conversation about how do we deal with the world when it's full of chaos around us. I had previously shared part of the poem by Rudyard Kipling when he said, if you keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything in it. And what's more, you'll be a man, my son. Great words, great words. And it's actually some pretty good, solid philosophy in life. Until we get the separate take on that from Gene Kerr, a comedian. Came along a little bit later, was quoting the poem and said it this way: if you can keep your head when all about are losing theirs, it's just possible that you haven't grasped the situation. And sometimes I feel more like that. It's like, what do you mean? We're totally justified in losing our minds over this. Don't you see what's going on? But no, honestly, we find ourselves in the midst of chaotic situations, and we jump to conclusions about the why of all of that. And I'm just throwing this in as a little bit of extra. So often I've seen people say, when someone has calamity come into their lives, and someone comes along and says, this is because of your sin. God's punishing you because you've done something wrong. Now you need to figure out what you've done and confess that and repent of that so God will remove this punishment from your life. That's pretty bad theology, my friends. Because truth of the matter is, if you are experiencing calamity in your life, the last thing to consider is that it's God punishing you. Example after example throughout the scripture, anyone that God uses, every person who's faithful to God, you find that that happens only after they've gone through great hardships. Seldom do you see someone who hasn't endured much suffering and much difficulty in life, being able to be strong in their faith. So the way the Bible describes it is, count it as joy that you're worthy to go through these kind of things. Be faithful to God. But here's a few thoughts I'd like to share about this. First of all, the chaos will never fix itself. Neither can you count on others to do it for you. We look at our world today, and I just get a big smile on when somebody says, no, it's going to be all right. The government will do something really smart and fix this. I'm like, yeah, because I've seen that happen so many times. When was the last time that happened? It's like, doubtful. Plus, we're not going to be able to stop them from whatever crazy thing they do anyway. That's part of the chaos, right? And so where do we go with this? It's not going to fix itself. We can't count on anyone else to fix it. Backing up, looking at the narrative we just read, here's a few quick examples. Verse 11. But the centurion, instead of listening to what Paul said, followed the advice of the pilot and the owner of the ship. He had no control there. He tried, but nope. And then we read that much time had been lost because they couldn't find a way where the wind was favorable or the seas were favorable to get where they wanted to be, completely out of everyone's control there. Again, in verse 15, we read, the ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind, so we gave way to it and were driven along. Now things are getting really scary. Once again, no decision they could make was going to change what that storm was doing. In verse 12, since the harbor was unsuitable to winter in, the majority decided we should sail on. Paul could have protested that all he wanted, but the majority had already decided. He didn't get his way there once again, did he? So all of these factors came into play, and none of them were within his control. Try as he might, nor was there anyone else who was fixing any of that. He had to just ride along on the decisions of others and on what nature was bringing their way. Say, well, he could have prayed. I'm certain they were praying, each and every one of them. It didn't change the storm, did it? So the second thing to do is this. Acknowledge that God is in control of even the most out-of-control situations. We could look at it all and say, oh my goodness, evil has just won the day, and there's no chance of righteousness or even the will of God coming out on this. It's over. And yet, the truth is, God is in control of even the most out-of-control situations. It might look like it, but God is saying, you just wait. These things are all serving my purpose, and in the end, you will be able to see that. We can't see it all right now, can we? Do you remember when Paul told them that God had given him an enlightenment, a message about this? This is true if we look at the Bible. We read about the Bible and it tells us how things are going to turn out in the end. And Paul says, it's all going to happen just as God told me. Look at our world today. Go back to your Bible and you can be certain of this. You can trust in God. It's all going to happen just as God said. It's all on track. Nothing is out of place. It just feels like it for us. That brings a lot of stability to us when our faith can grasp that. But God is in control of even the most out-of-control situation. It's what Paul said in verse 25. Keep up your courage, men. I have faith in God that it will happen just as he told me. We can trust God that it's all going to play out exactly as the Bible has foretold. I love what George Whitefield said about when our time comes. We are immortal until our work on earth is done. And I would add to that, we're not going to go till our time comes, but by our own testing of that or our foolishness, we can insert a lot of pain between now and then that is unnecessary. So that part is part of under our control, isn't it? But friends, recognize until God's done with you and your part is done here on earth, you're immortal. All of the veteran friends I've had who've gone off in combat zones and everything and come back would say, so many times I've heard, it just wasn't my time. There was a bullet with my name on it and somehow it missed. when it's your time, it'll be your time. Until then, serve God, trust God, be faithful. We don't have to figure out all the details. The third thing is this. Take note of the factors that are within your control. There's so much around us that we have no say in. Other people are making the decisions, or nature is bringing it our way, or we can't even find the source of different things going on. What are some of the things that are within our control that we can do something about? Well, a couple of ideas. First one is this. Take care of yourself. Above all else, try to keep yourself clear-headed and healthy to the best of your ability. Did you notice what had happened on board the ship that Paul was on? 14 days, and what had happened? They had been in such peril, in such distress, and under such a driving storm, they hadn't eaten. How many of you have gone 14 days without eating on purpose? On purpose. That's a lot. That's a lot. And so Paul's like, look, we got bread here, guys. You're going to need it to survive. You're going to have to swim ashore here once the ship runs aground. You don't know that yet. But you're going to need your energy. Here, some bread. Let's pray, give thanks to God for this, and let's eat. Take care of yourself. Try to be as healthy as you can and as prepared as you can be from that perspective. The second thing, lighten your load. You notice they started throwing things overboard off the ship. They were definitely lightening the load. We sometimes are overstressed because we're overcommitted, aren't we? We just can't say no. We keep saying yes, and we double and triple book ourselves, and we can't shut it off. We've just got too much going on to be able to calm down and relax and even get in touch with our own faith. Learn to say no to some things. Lighten your load. You got too many things on your back, figure out which ones you can jettison and throw a few things overboard and move on with a lighter load. Third thing, though, is this. Get ready to do your part. There's always going to be an opportunity when the time comes for you to do your part in this, to offer some stability in the world all around us. And that's one thing that I see as our part, as people of faith, people who believe in God and trust that God is in control. When the opportunity comes, we can be an example of stability by not being driven about by this. Get ready to do our part in this regard. And that's why I would go to the what can you take away from this today? A couple of things. And the first one is simply, you have no control over the chaos around you. We figured that out. We don't. We'd love to, but we don't. But you have control over you. You can make decisions and respond to the things around you in a way that makes sense for you. Take care of yourself. The second thought is simply, whenever and wherever you can, set that leadership example and be willing to do your part. And I'm just simply saying, by not being part of the chaos, we set an example. By being calm in the midst of that, by returning to our faith and saying, you know what? It looks like it's all out of control. We will have an opportunity to do our part at some point here. And when we need to take action, we will. But right now, we need to have faith in God, and we need to do the things that we know are right already. Let's do that and trust God for the outcome. This is a leadership example that every believer can follow. And what is that? Just be faithful to God. Do the things we already know are right, and trust God for the outcome. That's what faith is about. So let me ask you to pray with me now, okay?